Through it all. Thank him for the valleys, and I thank him for those storms already brought me through. Yeah. If I never had a problem, I never knew that God could solve them. I would never know what faith through it all. Thank him for the valleys, and I thank him for those storms already brought me through. Yeah. If I never had a problem, through it all. Thank him for the valleys, and I thank him for those storms already brought me through. Yeah. If I never had a problem, I never knew that God could solve them. I would never know what faith through it all. Thank him for the valleys, and I thank him for those storms already brought me through. Yeah. If I never had a problem, I never knew that God could solve them. I would never know what faith through it all.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, shall we rise to our feet for the national anthem? Let's sing it together. Distinguished celebrant, Honorable Sir Professor S.J.S. Cookie, OFRJP, His Excellency, the Executive Governor of River State, Sir Simenya Lai Fubara, GSSRS, KSCJP, here represented by Her Excellency, the Deputy Governor of River State, Professor Ngozi Maodo, DSSRS. Also seated on the high table is the 7th Vice Chancellor and Chairman Organizing Committee of all the events in honor of the celebrant as it turns 90, and that is Professor Joseph A. Ajayinka. A round of applause, please. Our guest lecturer, who is the first Vice President, Academy of International Affairs, Nigeria, Ambassador Dr. God Knows B. E. Gali. A round of applause, ladies. Also on the high table is the Vice Chancellor, University of Port Arthur, Professor Owonari A. Judge, who is the chief host, represented here today by the DVC admin, Professor Clifford Offerum. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause. Also the DVC academics, Professor Kingsley Owete. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. We also have on the high table Professor Iyoku Siminyalai, DVC Research and Development. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause. now through Professor Helen Emasialo, University Librarian. Ladies and gentlemen, let's put our hands together for her. I'm sure we have more people joining us on the high table, and when they come, we will introduce them very specially. But distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, today we have gathered day two of events lined up to celebrate and to honor an exemplary man, an administrator par excellence. He is an astute, erudite scholar and a philanthropist. Ladies and gentlemen, a man truly deserving of honor, none other than Honorable Sir Professor Sylvanus John Sodeye Kuki, OFRJP. I think we should put our hands together once again for him. It will interest you to know that of the about 8 billion people in our world today, only about 1 million people have celebrated 90 years. Truly remarkable. It's a good place to put your hands together. And we look at him, and there's so many things we can learn from him. The fact that we're here gathered to give honor and to present roses to a man while he is able to smell them. And that is why this event is so, so important. Now, I've just been told that we have the acting VC of Uniport for Headless Peace. Also, we have the acting VC of Uniport, Professor Stephen Okobo. Let's put our hands together. Former Pro-Chancellor, University of Port Harcourt, Mr. Right Honorable E. Chendo. Let's put our hands together for him. He's also a senator of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. All right, we proceed because we have a lot on our schedule this morning, and we must do justice to them. I'm aware we're expecting some more dignitaries, and when they come in, we will introduce them. But right now, to give us the welcome address, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to welcome the chairman of the organizing committee, Professor J.A. Ajayinka, as he steps forward for the welcome address. Please put your hands together.
The chairman of this occasion, the executive governor of River State, ably represented by the deputy governor of the state, our own Professor Ngozi Adu, who is here in our midst, and we're indeed very glad to have you here now. Let me stand on the protocol already established. Today is very important in the annals of the University of Port Harcourt. We are gathered here, friends, family, old boys of the famous Okrika Grammar School, alumni of the University of Port Harcourt, and alumni of the University College, and now the Premier University of Ibadan. Professor Kuki did not attend University of Ibadan, he attended University College Ibadan. Mentees, students, we are gathered here to celebrate a distinguished scholar and university administrator, our second vice chancellor, who is exactly 90 years old today. We are gathered here to celebrate a man of outstanding scholarship and service. Distinguished Professor H.J.S. Kuki has been everything in the university system in Nigeria and abroad. Lecturer, Professor of History, Head of Department, Dean of Faculty, Vice Chancellor, Vice Chancellor for Bafoni Awolowo University. We are gathered here to celebrate a transformational leader who laid the foundation for transforming this university into an entrepreneurial university. I only pronounce entrepreneurial university. We laid the foundation for it. I'm recalling this so that we can learn from his life of scholarship and service. We are gathered here, alumni, friends and family, mentees and community, to celebrate a consummate scholar, an academic general, a giant Iroko under whose canopy many find shade and succor, a quintessential public intellectual, an outstanding leader, a patriot, flag bearer and torch bearer, a knight of the Anglican Church, and indeed President General of the Knights of the Church of Nigeria, a chief of the famous Opobo Kingdom, a proud son of the Niger Delta. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm recalling this so that we can learn from his life of selfless service to community. We are gathered here to celebrate a well-decorated academic general, president of the Students' Union of the University College, Ibadan. A man engaged in patriotic struggles, justice of the peace, officer of the Federal Republic. Your Excellency, ma'am, I'm recalling this so that we all need to know his life of patriotic struggles and learn that there are many men, but few gentlemen. The distinguished professor, fondly called LGS Kuki, in whose honor we are gathered here today, is a fine gentleman, a polished gentleman, very urbane. We are celebrating an outstanding patriot, our LGS Kuki, whose name rings a bell, a big bell, a man of all seasons, fit as fiddle, sportsman, an avid golfer, a visionary leader with aristocratic courage of a proud heritage, committed to the legacy of service and a culture of excellence, whose reputation goes before him. In this university, at the quadrangle of the School of Humanities and the Social Sciences, we are told there are professors with small p and professors with capital P. Professor A.J.S. Kuki is a professor with capital P. We are happy celebrating him among friends and family in good health, among old boys of OGS, among alumni of Uniport and the Premier University, the Great Rye. Your Excellency, ma'am, our celebrant wants to dedicate the rest of his life in scholarship and service, in university advancement, and build bridges for the development and progress of our communities. At the end of this celebration, we shall commit resources to establish the Kuki Institute of West Africa and Diaspora Studies and promote community heritage programs. Ladies and gentlemen, to the best of my knowledge, the University of Port Harcourt is the first in this country to establish a unique community service program. And we want to rededicate our lives to community service through the heritage program. Our prayerful wish for him is strength and good health, and many more years of selfless service to community and to his creator. Let me very specially welcome all of you to this distinguished gathering to celebrate an international scholar, distinguished professor, community leader, Alabasta Professor A.J.S. Kuki, at 90, with an intellectual harvest. The celebration actually started 2 days ago on Sunday. Let the celebration continue. Welcome to Unique Report. Thank you very much.
Thank you. you so much, Mr. Chairman of the Organizing Committee and the 7th Vice Chancellor of this prestigious University of Port Harcourt. Once again, Professor J.A. Ajayinka. Let's put our hands together for him. And now, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to welcome for her address, the pride of Oba Land and a woman who is truly extraordinary. And move on very quickly. I'd like to welcome at this time for the citation of our guest lecturer. Ladies and gentlemen, again, once again, I apologize. I'd like to welcome the chief host and the chairman of the occasion, the vice chancellor of this prestigious university, Professor Owonari A. Jodwo, represented by the DVC, and named Professor Clifford Ofwin. Please put your hands together for him.
Deputy Governor, Your Excellency, Professor Ngozi Odum, one of our own, the chairman of the organizing committee on this occasion, our 7th vice chancellor, Professor Joseph Ajayinka, the man of the moment, our 2nd Vice Chancellor, Professor S.J.S. Cookie, Ambassador Goldberg's Gali, the former Pro-Chancellor of our university, Andrew Uchendu, Senator, distinguished Senator Andrew Uchendu, the Deputy Vice Chancellor Academic, Professor Q.C. Owete, Deputy Vice Chancellor Research and Development, Professor Yopos Malayan, Registrar of our university, Dr. Gloria Chinga, our university librarian, Professor Marciano Helen, former Vice Chancellor, the 8th Vice Chancellor, Professor Yuri Romano, former 10th Vice Chancellor, Professor Steve Okojuju, distinguished professors, director of centers and institutes, the family of the salad banks, members of the first distinguished or unique students of the University of Port Harcourt, ladies and gentlemen, let me, I'm Governor Knight Vice Chancellor, Professor Owonari Abraham Jodwo, welcome everybody, especially those who are coming to the University of Port Harcourt for the very first time for this occasion. I said that because I know that for over 80% of here, of us here, it is but a homecoming. Because it's either you are related to University of Port Harcourt by friendship or through work. Whatever it is, I know about 80% to you is a homecoming. Professor SJS Cooking at 90. When I saw Professor Cooking yesterday, something just ran through my mind. I told myself that it is good to be 90. And if you know how important, or if you want to know how important this celebration is for this university, if I still recall, this is the first time in a very long time that all the previous vice chancellors, you know, have shut off whatever is in their program to be in attendance. That goes a long way to tell us the nature and the man that we are celebrating. My prayer, we have lost Professor Nini Briggs just over 70. But going forward, for any man that God has opportunity to serve this university, they will grow and if possible grow older than Professor Cookie. Once more, I want to thank our Deputy Vice Chancellor Research and Development for the untiring efforts he has put in to ensure that this program turns out the way it is. Don't forget that we are in a period that we do not know which days are public holidays, which days are work days. Other than that, this one would have been fully packed. But because of the inconsistencies in the holidays, that's why you are seeing it this way. But for you that fight everything to be here, my prayer is that the same way that we're celebrating this man today, that is also the same way that others will celebrate you. Deputy Vice Chancellor, man, you have heard it from Professor Joseph Angelica. We want to use something, we want to use tangible thing in honor of Professor SJS Cookie. And like Professor Angelica said, a center that we're going to use to immortalize him. So be our emissary and also our ambassador to the government, because this is a task that we want to accomplish, and the time to accomplish that task is now. On that note, ladies and gentlemen, once more I welcome to the University of Port Harcourt, and may God bless you richly. Amen.
Thank you once again. Let's put our hands together for the chairman of the occasion. Thank you very much, sir. Now, while he was speaking, someone very, very important walked into our midst, and it's my pleasure and honor to recognize His Majesty King Dr. Dandasin Douglas Jaja, CFR, DSSRS, JP, Jackie V, Treaty King, Natural Ruler, and a Mayanable of Oropobo Kingdom. He's also former chairman of the River State Council of Traditional Rulers, and of course, Chancellor Federal University, Dutsima, Katsina State. Again, a round of applause for him. Thank you very much for being here. He's a royal father of the week. And I'd like to use the opportunity to also recognize all of the royal fathers who are seated with us today. At this time, I'd like to welcome to take the citation of the guest lecturer, the Dean of the Faculty of Humanities, Professor John Yesemo. Please step forward, ladies and gentlemen. Let's give him a round of applause. To read the citation of the guest lecturer today.
Thank you.
Ambassador Dr. Godless Bolade Ighali, PhD, OOM. Ambassador Ighali was born on 4th April 1960. Amongst other qualifications, he holds a PhD, Politics and International Studies from Venezuela, Master's in International Law and Diplomacy, UNILAG, Postgraduate in International Relations from Foreign Service Academy, BA History, UNIPOS, from the Pioneer Students. He served for over 30 years in various Nigerian embassies. I was appointed Nigerian Consul General in Cameroon between 1999 and 2005, and later Nigerian Ambassador to Sweden, Denmark, Norway, and Finland. While in the Scandinavian countries, he was predicted to have fundamentally opened up Nigeria to investments from those countries and double the level of cooperation in the educational sector. He was in 2010 appointed a federal permanent secretary and served in the Federal Ministry of Water Resources and the Federal Ministry of Power till 2015. As a top federal civil servant, he was recruited for various reform initiatives and brought critical thinking to the work of governance and public administration. For 6 months, he acted as Minister of Power and retired meritoriously from federal service in November 2015. In 2021, he was appointed 12th Co-Chancellor, Federal University of Technology at Akure, and is also 2nd Co-Chancellor, Bayelsa Medical University. He's been alternate chairman, Committee of Co-Chancellors of Nigerian Universities, and is currently also 1st Vice President, Academy of International Affairs. It's widely published, including his award-winning book, Perspectives in Nations Transformation in Contemporary Africa, as well as his seminal work, Global Trends in State Formation, an Inquiry into the Origin, Survival, and Demise of States. Another major work is the Diplomacy of Economic Development, while he also has to his credit over 100 published research articles and other books. He is a Fellow of the Historical Society of Nigeria, Fellow Nigerian Institute of Management, Fellow Academy of International Affairs, Nigeria. He has led Nigerian delegations to various countries, including Ethiopia, Zimbabwe, Namibia, Jamaica, Liberia, World Bank, etc. He was honored by President Olusegun Obasanjo, Officer of the Order of the Niger. Dr. Godless Bolade Ighali is married to Mrs. Tufemi Ighali, and their marriage is blessed with children. Your Excellency, Vice Chancellor, Sir, distinguished invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, I present to you an astute intellectual, a seasoned administrator, a technocrat, an environmentalist, a proud son of Ileware, Ambassador Dr. Godless B. Ighali, OON, to deliver the guest lecture. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think we can do much better than that as we welcome for his lecture right now, Ambassador Dr. Godless B. Ighali, OON, First Vice President, Academy of International Affairs, Nigeria.
Thank you very much. Your Excellency, the Governor of Rivers State, your representative and my sister, one of us, the Deputy Governor, the Vice Chancellor of this university, and all other former Vice Chancellors. Let me especially recognize my colleague, Senator Chief Andrew Chengu, the appointed co-chancellors in the 2022 and the recent election, December 5th, this lucky to remain here at home. Very close to honor her. So, I want to specially recognize somebody very dear to my heart. All my life and so, that's my father, Professor Izu Alagbala. We have sat here quietly through the activities of the day. Let me also recognize our king that I'm going to introduce sufficiently. Actually, you realize as we converse that this lecture I'm going to give has a lot to do with the kingship, loyalty, and politics of our coastal states. I'm sorry, we're having a difficulty in streaming it, but the purpose of the lecture we'll be giving shortly. I'd like to thank the members of the organizing committee led by my brother, Professor Jenka. I was protesting if you watched we were talking because I thought that if you come to give a lecture on the day when somebody is being honored, the citation should be as abridged as possible. Just call your name from the top. These glasses are endemic in the university system. And I thought with Professor Jenka I can succeed. But I didn't succeed. And my current lawyer and approach chancellor at Western Medical University. I propose it again. I said, no, just call my name. But this professor Jenka posed with thoughts for me. Well, I want to thank all our other respected dignitaries who are present. They are giving call me by name, please. It's not about the slant. I know the hall is full of very important personalities. I was telling Professor Pickett. This is one of the most qualitative audiences you can have in gathering somebody. The quality of human beings here, my daughter. Whatever I've heard later, international relations, international, I'm essentially a historian. People sometimes remember, when I write from history, sometimes I try to interpass it with international relations and contemporary issues. So they don't feel that. But I'm essentially a historian who meant at the feet of Professor Lagwa, Professor Hacking, Professor Hutton, Professor K. Williamson, and so on. But as I see you, sometimes we forget some of them. So, this is a conversation on history, and I thank Professor Jenka and the Vice Chancellor for bringing us. This university, we have stood out in the midst of all the third generation universities. We are the only one that has produced the president of this country. First the vice president, then the president. The president of Dr. Goodmark, Attorney Jonathan. And so we summoned somebody I believe who is on his way. We don't have any time for now. And then we can beat our chest and boast of the area of governors who have produced Nicholas Silver of Bielsa State, Governor Chibuike Amuchi of Rivers State, and Deputy Governor Dorotiri of Bielsa State, and Governor Alex Oti of Abia State, and so many deputy governors, including our excellency, who is here with us. So, I don't think there's any university of our time that has had that kind of lineup of national service people in different areas. And that is because of the qualitative foundation that was laid in this university and has been sustained over the time by succeeding vice chancellors. So I must congratulate you. And but today's celebration is particularly auspicious because we have gathered to venerate in a very distinctive manner the life's worth and contributions into the knowledge industry in so many areas of national service for one of those who laid the foundation of this university. Indeed, the entire university community deserves for us to appreciate them that you have built in this place the world leading universities. You know, this rating of universities, I have issues with Professor Kemikola over rating of universities because the University of Port Harcourt always comes on top, but after some time the rating goes down. And But I believe that this university is the university in Nigeria, and that is why we are unique. And kudos to all the vice chancellors and leaders. Well, to speak on Professor Kuki is quite daunting. Even for the best storyteller, we know the students are essentially storytellers. And I will talk about that. So what I'm going to have a conversation about is talking about the historian, talking about national service, and the very unique service of Professor Sibanos. And we see that the question is always asked, who are the students? Who are these students? Some people think that the students are simplicity, those who tell students to graduate. That is famous inaugural lecture, the Pantheon's Eye, which is the classicus on talking about defining what history is about. He said, yes, I would prefer to be the person that will unearth what has happened in the past so that we can create a link with today and be able to cut out impact for us for tomorrow. So, generation upon generation, historians have been atop the global scene and service. We, even in this country, we have seen, just like Professor Kuki, so many historians of worth, so many names to call, if you go globally, Anatombi, or John Keegan. But the common here, Kenneth Dickey, was not only a historian or storyteller, but he was the first archivist of this country, the National Archives. He built it to tell the story of Nigeria from the past, coming up to the time when he started to be in charge of the National Archives. A country without an archive is a country that does not know where it is going. But maybe in the language of Professor Claude Mackey, not going on a journey without a map. So Professor Kenneth Dickey was able to establish the National Archive where people like Professor Magwa were some of his pioneer staff. And he mentored virtually all of them and served the country in so many other places. Of course, we remember so many other people and so many names, but let me just focus on one or two persons. Tegan Atamno, one of our own, Professor Baro Kimi, and Professor Jill and Fibu, and so many. And of course, by no means and no less, Professor Lagwa, Chief Kalajo. These days, we prefer calling him, instead of Prof, I prefer calling him his traditional title, Chief Kalajo of Mungo. And these are people that academics, historians, storytellers, and there are so many here with us today, but have always made themselves available to service. Why is it so important that historians are in our top in serving? Because the discipline, and I don't want to go into the documentation, whether it's a science or it's an art, but then it is a subject that is like an umbrella that covers every other discipline. And you are able to say everything about every other area, about economics, about politics, about sociology, about health. That's why every discipline has the history of that discipline. So historians cover everywhere. So the periscopic approach, the periscopic sight of the historian is very good. Because Alagwa simply put it as a Python style. The Python style, and I've written that, he took a cover from the Puri people. He says that the Python is able to, eye of the Python is able to see the past. You see, the Python of all the Rotarians, the Python sees both the past, the back view, and the front view at the same time. And that's what the story has. But of course, Alagwa goes further. In aggravating the fact that the duty of the historian is like listening to ants. Ant is the tiniest physical organism, not microscopic. And there are very tiny ants, which you can't even see with the eyes, but they are walking about. And Professor Lago says that, I can't really quote the quote over here. He says that historian is like that ant that, when you listen to the ground, you think that giants are marching to the front. That is how you come into the details. And you listen closely to what has happened, and you think that it's an army of ants, an army of generals marching, but actually it is ants that are just moving about. So that's the detail to which the Sudan is found are useful. And that, and of course the truth, we've spoken about truth of historiography, which are very scientific. Because you must be able to say what you've learned, analyze it, cross-check it, and recheck, and recheck. You start to be kind of start capricious. You must cross-check and check in such a way that you are able to come up with truth, which as much as possible, cannot be absolute, but as much as possible represents even what actually happened in the past. And there's some traditional scientists, like among some of the people of Senegal, Sierra Leone, and Mali. Traditional, the great, it's a man who takes an oath, almost at the risk of his life, not to tell a lie. So from generation to generation, he says what has happened, and if he says something that is not accurate, it's almost at the peril of his life. And you know, many other courts, like he said. So this is a kind of talk about the types of groups of people that have been taught to listen clearly and be able to serve the society with a broad view and an empirical perspective of any situation. So we see in history that kings, presidents, bishops, popes, found almost in every palace historians whose duty was always to be able to be in the administration. And that's why a man like Professor Kuki that we are celebrating today. But even in the Bible, it says that we should ask and we should seek and we will find, we should knock. So the duty of the historian is to keep asking, to keep seeking. And even if you look at the word science, the science, it means just inquire and bring it out to which is same too. So it is not maybe like one article for something that say legitimacy of conversion. It's not that I'm trying to justify my truth as a historian, but bearing open why people are persecuting and serve this country in many places. And even if you go further, you bring in a man like Professor Berufaka, who wants to go underground to dig, to see what has been unearthed and covered. Then he takes it to Professor Lagwa, they sit down together to persecute, they now interpret what has been buried. And then they now go to the chemical scientists and take it to where the carbon dating and are able to put time to what has been brought down from the ground. That shows the level of precision, and that is why Professor Kuki has come out as he is today, a great Nigerian nationalist, a great serviceman, who this country has found fully worthy in every area that has been given to serve. Now, having said that, I'd like to spend a few minutes to talk on the historic city of Jaja, and I'm happy King Jaja is here, Kuki, and their burning roots. It's impossible to talk about Professor Kuki without going back to that great city of Bonny. And that is because of all the coastal cities in Nigeria, if you go back to Badagry, you go to Benin, you go to a place like Bas, Akasa, it was the city that was became like what they used to call small London. And Bonny was the most metropolitan, of all these cities. Most of the other ones were ethnically circumscribed. But Bonny became a place that was gathering of everybody. It was easily accessible, and it became a home to all. And the social fabric nations including America, Bonny was the center of where everybody was. And Professor Kuki's roots go back to that town of Bonny. A highly organized town where you have the Amainabo. Who is Amainabo? The Amainabo is a territorial sovereign. Amainabo, the owner of the town. So at any given time, the place of the Amainabo was sacrosanct. He was the one, the simple interpretation. I read somewhere where there's a disputation between Amainabo, which means the man who is leading the town, Amayanabo. Somebody said, who is superior? Is it Amayanabo or Amadabo? Amadabo is a person leading, but Amayanabo has undisputed territoriality, territorial sovereignty. And that helped Boni a lot because he developed kingship at South early time. And it also helped other places like Calabaris, the people of Mingo, but we have the Amayana body, the owner of the town. So he was a sovereign and he was a patron of culture, of commerce, of industry, of politics. So he created an ambience for everybody to try. But Boni was also helped by
of Sylvanus Kuki must talk about Jaja of Opobo, because Jaja of Opobo's story started, it didn't start from Boni actually, it started from Amigbo in Imo State, but he ended up in Boni, as we know, as a young man. I have my lecture, the details are there, let me just run through it. At quite an early age, maybe about 12, 13, but what is critical is the fact that, which perhaps I should have mentioned earlier, there was a system of cultural assimilation, not peculiar to Boni, but many other cultures have it, where a hardworking young person who comes, no matter how he started, could aspire to the highest place. So King Jaja came into Boni at quite a young age and was able to prove his mettle as a person of hard work, of principle, of character. And he climbed steadily. Mind you, slave trade was abolished in 1807. Slavery was abolished in 1837. So by the time he arrived, Boni, those ones were already law in all the realms under the British Empire. So he came in and was able to prove himself by dint of hard work. But could a man who is from rags get to riches? Could he go from grass to grace? Yes. So I come back again to the issue of the amenableship and the polo system, of course, with all the chieftaincies and so on. It allowed that situation. It allowed a situation where hard work became part of the society. It was ingrained that through hard work, you could climb. There may be a limit to which you can climb. You may not become a miner, but you can become even a war canoe chief by your hard work. You can become a major. And that is what happened with Jaja of Opobo. In history, we've had so many of such cases. I remember we had the case of Sundiata, who was the founder of the Mali Empire. And he was a boy that was in rag. He was disabled. And when it was his turn to become a chief, his stronger uncles, everybody took power from him. But Sundiata, through hard work, came back and formed one of the biggest empires later and became an uncle of the man that is considered the richest man ever in history, Mansa Musa of Mali. But Sundiata was able to build the empire. And the same way in those who are, read a lot of Bible, the story of King David, the story of Joseph in the Bible, from the same several orphan-like kind of background, the true character, true hard work could rise. And that's what exactly happened in the case of King Jaja of Opobo. With Professor Kuki Gladly is one of the main biographers on King Jaja of Opobo. Although Professor Walter Fonagoro, Dr. Walter Fonagoro, who is from Amigbo, thinks that what Professor Kuki wrote, his 1974 book, King Jaja of Niger Delta, is incomplete because He did not go into the details of Amigo, how he left Amigo, which Dr. Walter Fonagoro has now been able to add in his book in 1978. But then I see a lacuna between Professor Kuki and Fonagoro. The last work, major work that I've read, that is in the shelves, is in 1978, Fonagoro's work. And I think it's a challenge because the epical nature of Jaja's life, it's a story that will be told and retold for generations. And I think it's something that young scholars, researchers have to dig more. Because in the process of preparing for this lecture, I had to consult back home in Amigbo, in Imo State, in Inquiry, and so on. And there are so many sides of the story. And I don't think that, with all due respect to Professor Kuki, there's a finality. We have to keep digging into exactly what happened. Somebody told me, an elderly man from Amigbo, he said, listen to me. They've not told you that Jaja's father was a big chief, very strong man, and after his death, Jaja became stubborn. They gave him assignment to do. They punished him; he wouldn't do it. So that's how the other chiefs gathered to sell him into slavery. But that's not the only story. There are other stories, but I don't want to get into that argument in this place. But the challenge is for younger scholars to dig more. So maybe like Dr. Fonagoro said, let us go back to Umuduro in Amigbo and start from there and be able to decipher and sift out what might not. But the important thing is that he came as a slave boy and became a major factor. In the two main ruling families in Borni, the Manila people and the Ani people. And he found himself crossed in between and between them. And as it will turn out to be, his disagreement with another fellow, Okojumbo, who was another fellow Igbo man of Igbo background, who came into Borni also, and became quite strong. So like I said, it's the sociology of the societies that allowed this kind of upward progression. Although sometimes we see there's a concern about linguistic reversal. Linguistic reversal is not a problem in history. In history, we see that there are many societies where a small language becomes the dominant language. When we talk of Hausa, Hausa is the seven habit states between Katsina, Kano, and some part of Zamfara and so on. But Hausa is the lingua franca of the entire north of Nigeria, coming up to the River Benue. So the confluence. So it's an aspect of linguistic reversal. And it was, for me, reading through the books and sifting through the records, it was mostly mercantilist. It was the commerce of the time that dictated that it's good for us to be able to operate. You see, now in Europe, everybody speaks English, even the French. If you see French people, they speak English. Why? Because English, as small as they are, is a language of business. And that is what we saw happen. But the critical thing is that Jaja became quite famous. And we know all that happened, and eventually he had to leave. The problems in Borni were not peculiar to Borni. They were peculiar in the Kalabari nation, they were peculiar in the Kalabari sub-nation, they were peculiar in Nembe, in these states that became centralized. You know, this concept of war canoe houses, it operates only in two parts of the world. In the North Pacific, they have two, three ethnic groups. Similar, exactly same canoes as us. This big Omungaro, this big boats from there to here, where one man is the owner, is the patron of all this business, and then they have the other smaller boats. So your ability to be a war canoe chief is the fact that you can boast of so many other flotilla behind you, and you can put cannons, and you can be able to operate. So it was both commercial, sociocultural in nature. And those struggles are always there. And as we know, Jaja eventually had to move to what became Opobo. Now, how does all these things concern Kuki? If you go dig deeper in the history, in all Jaja's upward movement and travels, there was a name of somebody that was always by his side, and that is the name Kuki Gam. Kuki Gam, at the time, was a young man that early in life came to be part of Western scholarship. He educated himself, including going to England to school. And I would have preferred if of the audience. I'll finish in a few minutes. I'm already almost towards the end. So there was a name, Cookie Gam. And Cookie Gam, although he was a homeboy from Bonny, he educated himself, followed Bishop Ajay Crowder. Ajay Crowder became a bishop in 1864 in when he was made, when he was ordained a priest. And he came right down to Bonny. There's a problem there now, which I've mentioned is controversial, because I wrote an article about 3 years ago, and the primate of the Anglican Church was not happy with me, because I contested that the original cathedral in Nigeria is St. Stephen's in Bonny. Because if you go to St. Stephen's in Bonny, you see King Jack Crowder's lantern, you see his prayer where he knelt down to pray, you see his bed, and that is where he came straight from England to form his bishopric. It was called Bishop of the Niger. It was not Niger Delta, of the Niger. But somehow we now take things to Abeokuta, to St. Peter's in Abeokuta. But I wrote that article, it was widely circulated, and unfortunately it was circulated, and I could not withdraw it. But the contention is there is that one of the young men that was following Bishop Ajay Crowder and doing all this church work was a young man known as Cookie Gam. But Cookie Gam, beyond that, was also a diplomat of his time, because he was also very close to the other side that were in contention with Jaja, and was a bridge between them. But he stood by Jaja, and even when Jaja left in 1869, and eventually King Ibanechuka of Okreka and King Amakri the Great of Calabar now brokered a peace and brought peace in 1873.